Welcome to module three of our Fiddleheads mini workshop. So this is a continuation of our sort of vocabulary conversation, focusing this time on reproductive vocabulary, the vocabulary associated with fern reproduction. And first of all, when we speak of reproduction of ferns, we normally mean spore production, which of course, when you think about it, is different than what we mean in animals. When we talk about reproduction animals, we are talking about fertilization, the production of a new diploid. Whereas with ferns, when we speak of reproduction, usually we're talking about the production of spores. And we say if a fern is fertile, we mean it's making spores. We don't mean it's making sperm and eggs, which of course only happens in the gametophytes, which we rarely see. So just a quick reminder, when it comes to fertility, we're talking about the production of spores by a sporophyte, typically speaking. And how does this happen? Well, most ferns produce their spores in a structure called a sporangium. Well, they all do, but most of them produce it in a very particular type of sporangium, which we'll introduce in greater depth in a minute. But it's this amazing structure. So inside here, you can see the spores. These are the individual spores. Oops, sorry. And around the edge, there's a thickened set of cells, kind of like a rim, if you will. And the faces are very thin. And if we look at what that looks like a little bit more closely, what happens is that by basically water pressure alone, these cells store up tension, pull this whole part back. This is called the annulus, these cells. And then there's a release of that tension by cavitation that propels the spores out. And the spores get propelled out at upwards of 10,000 times the force of gravity. So 10,000 Gs. When you think about human fighter pilots or whatever, we pass out at, I don't know, it's like 10 Gs or something like that. This is an acceleration of 10,000 times the force of gravity. So unbelievable acceleration. And all passively done. The plant isn't itself shooting this catapult, so to speak. It's just water pressure that does it. So quite an amazing structure to eject the spores. This is called a leptosporangium. And so the arrangement of these sporangia is really important for identifying ferns. Sporangia are often arranged in clusters, which we call sori, or in a singular, we call them a sorus. And so if anyone has ever spoken of spore dots, looked at on the side of a fern, said, oh, look at those spore dots. Those are sori that you're looking at. And so here's an example of a bunch of sporangia clustered together into a sorus. This sorus is not protected by a flap, so we call it exindusiate. Whereas if it is protected by a flap, which we call an indusium, we would say that's an indusiate sorus. So here is a sorus that's being protected by an umbrella-like indusium. Here's one that has a kidney-shaped indusium. Here's a linear sorus that has a linear indusium along one side, et cetera. So the shape of the sorus and the characteristics of the indusium are really helpful for identifying particular groups of ferns. Here's a linear sorus that has an indusium that opens towards the midvein. If I see that, I know already what family of ferns this is without seeing anything else about it. So the arrangement of the sporangia and the presence or absence of an indusium is really useful. There's another very important term just to know, which is that an indusium, I should clarify, is an outgrowth of the leaf. So it's like part of the leaf tissue that grows and forms this flap. An alternative that many ferns do is they don't make some new outgrowth. Instead, they just curl the edge of the leaf over. And if it's just the edge of the leaf that's curled over to protect the sporangia, we call that a false indusium. You may also see the term pseudo-indusium. So here's a good example of a false indusium. Here's another one. The edge of the leaf is curling over to protect the sporangia. This is a false indusium. Then there's some other really interesting ways that the sporangia can be arranged that are specific to some very particular groups, including a synangium, which is a fused sporangia, where they're fused together. And I'll talk about that in one particular group a little bit later. So here's an example. We're looking at the underside of a fern leaf, and we're seeing these little flap-like structures. And you can kind of see sticking out here, that's the annulus. So this is a sporangium that has opened. Here's another one, here's another one, here's another one, here's another one. There will have been dozens of sporangia underneath this flap. And so this flap is an indusium, and this cluster of sporangia is a sorus. In this particular case, the sorus is linear. It's longer than it is wide, and it's covered by an indusium that opens towards the midrib. And that in and of itself tells us that this is in the Blechnaceae, the chain fern family. In fact, this particular plant is a chain fern. Let's look at another example. Here is another cluster of Sporangia. You can barely see them because it's also covered by an indusium. But the indusium this time isn't linear. Well, first of all, the sorus itself is round as opposed to being linear. And then the indusium that's covering it, I don't know how well you can see, but it's kidney shaped. And it happens to be covered with all of these long sort of colorless hairs. And again, that's pretty much sufficient to tell us that this is in the marsh fern family. I'm showing you these slides just so you get a bit of an idea of what you would be looking for if you found a plant in the wild. Here's an example where you can see the sporangia really clearly. So each of these little balls is a sporangium that will contain 64 spores inside of it. And they are arranged linearly right along the edge of the leaf. And they're protected by a flap, but the flap is an outgrowth of the edge of the leaf. It's not an outgrowth of the leaf itself, it's just the sort of the edge has curled over. And so this is what we call a false indusium. This is a genus Aspidotus. Here's another case that is a little bit trickier to describe, perhaps. Each of these little balls is its own sporangium. So lots and lots of sporangia. They're not really arranged into sori in this case, into clusters. Instead, they're spread evenly across the underside of the leaf. And we have a special term for that, which is called acrosticoid. So if anyone ever says that the sori are acrosticoid, it means that the sporangia are spread all evenly across the underside of the leaf. There's not very many ferns in our flora that do that. Pretty much just a silverback and goldback fern. Here's another example. The sorus is linear. You can see all the annula sticking out from where the sporangia were. It's also protected by a flap. This is indeed a true indusium. It's part of the leaf that's growing out. But this indusium is opening away from the midvein. And so in many ways, quite similar to Blechnaceae, that first one we saw. But the fact that it's opening away tells us that this is in the Spleniaceae, the spleenwort family. And I think this is the last example. Again, you can see hints of these round sporangia. They haven't released their spores yet. They're arranged around the edge of the leaflet. So they are a linear sorus, and they're protected by the curled over edge of the leaf. So this is another example of a false indusium. All right, so let's do the same sort of exercise that we did for vegetative features. Imagine that you found a fern, you forgot your field guide. What sorts of things should you do to be able to look it up when you get home? Well, the first thing you should do is look at the underside. As a bit of an aside, I spend a perhaps unhealthy amount of time on a web app called iNaturalist, where people post their observations of organisms. And I look at people's fern observations, and a lot of them don't show you the underside of the fern. And it's very hard to, much harder to identify something without photographs or information about the underside. So the underside is where the spores are. Look at the underside. Really make sure you look at the underside. And while you're doing that, note the shape and position of the sori. Are they round? Are they linear? Are they towards the edge? Are they in the middle? And then shape and position of the indusia. Is there an indusium in the first place? If there is, what type of indusium is it, a true or a false? How is it attached? Is it attached by a central stalk or on one side and folded over? Do they open towards the vein, away from the vein, etc.? And that should be enough to tell you, to put you in an excellent position to identify your fern.